So friends, Poya Day and Ruta Poya Day, 1st January 2018. First meditation session, 2.5 hours of metta, universal friendliness. The seat is ready. Second thing, the training is sustained by not eating and not sleeping on observance days, Uposatha days. That is every new moon and every full moon. Very good training with very good results. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends. Just a minor update on what to do on Uposatha days and what I practiced, both among monastics and lays. And monastics, they recite the Vinaya code on this full moon and new moon days. And the Vinaya code is what you see in this library. Actually, it's only this book, but the whole Vinaya, the whole code is in these 6 books. However, the lay people should just observe this, the 8 precepts that I will explain in a minute. Then secondly, so this is the observance itself. Then secondly, one can meditate and then change from sitting meditation. Here you see my meditation seat. And then walking meditation, usually outside, especially during the night. And then Dhamma study. And then what to study? Yes, any Buddhist should of course study the words of the Buddha himself. Because how can you call yourself or regard yourself as a Buddhist if you have not studied the word of the Buddha himself? And I'm now, as you see, studying the numerical discourses of the Buddha, which you see here on the left. But I regard or recommend that everybody goes through the entire Sutta Pitaka, which is the third middle of this library you can see here. So they are embedded in these books, the Digha Nikaya, the Madhyama Nikaya, the Samyutta Nikaya, and the Anguttara Nikaya, which you've just seen. One good commentary I can recommend also is the Path of Purification, Visuddhimagga, which you see here. Then there's also the last Nikaya, which actually is fairly extensive, which goes from here in this library to, let's see here, Vimana Stories here. So something like 10-15 volumes among those, the Dhammapada, but these are small texts. This ideally one study 3 times in one life, in one life length, before one dies. Huh? I'm on my second going through the entire Tipitaka. And I'm confident that before I die, I will be able to read the entire Tipitaka 3 times. I would recommend getting or reading on the PDF files systematically on every Poya day, that is on every full moon day and new moon day, keeping the 8 precepts, doing meditation, walking and sitting, and then reading this text. The latest translations, especially by Bhikkhu Bodhi, is fairly good. They are much better than the older translations there are. So I can very much recommend them. This will, as we will hear later on, increase the probability of a divine rebirth. As the Buddha himself explained, that as you will hear in the suttas, I'll read aloud in a moment, these 8-factored observance days are enough to induce divine existence after death. Thank you. Hello to you, friends. This is about Uposatha observance, which is a practice important both for lay Buddhist and also monastic Buddhist. It takes place at full moon days and at new moon days, that is twice a month. And this is the explanation and the Buddha's recommendation of it. Uposatha days are times of renewed dedication to the Dhamma practice. It is observed both by lay followers and monastics throughout the world of Theravada Buddhism. For our monastics, it is often days of intensive reflection and meditation. On new moon day and full moon days, the fortnight confession and recitation of the Bhikkhu Patimokkha, the monastic disciplinary code, the Vinaya, often takes place. Lay people observe the 8 precepts on Uposatha Poya days as a support for meditation practice and as a way to re-energize commitment and dedication to the Dhamma. Whenever possible, lay people use these days as an opportunity to visit the local monastery or forest monk in order to make special offerings to the Sangha, to listen to the Dhamma, and to practice meditation with Dhamma companions late into the night. So also it has a social function that one meets together with other Kalyanamittas, other beautiful friends in the community of Buddhist disciples, the Sangha. For those closely affiliated with a local monastery or a local monk, it can simply be an opportunity to pay a visit and to step on one's effort in meditation while drawing into invisible support of millions of others practicing Buddhist on these 2 same days of new moon day and full moon day. The 8 precepts at the Sila, observed by lay people during periods of intense meditation practice and these lunar observance days. The 8 precepts, our training rules, are based on the 5 precepts, with the 3rd precept extended to prohibit all sexual activity, an additional 3 precepts that are especially supportive to meditative practice. And they go like this, the 8 precepts. 1. I undertake the training rule to refrain from all destroying of living creatures, all killing. 2. I undertake the training rule to abstain from taking what is not giving, not stealing. 3. I undertake precept the training rule to refrain from all sexual activity, including masturbation. 4. I undertake the precept to refrain from all false speech or incorrect speech. 5. I undertake the precept to avoid all intoxicating drinks and drugs that leads to carelessness. 6. I undertake the training rule of not eating after noon. So only eating from dawn, from you can see the light and the wrinkles in your fingers, and then until 12 o'clock noon. I undertake the precept to refrain from dancing, singing, music, going to see entertainments, wearing garlands, using perfumes, and beautifying the body with cosmetics. 8. I undertake the precept to refrain from lying on high or luxurious beds. This we will take the sutta from the Anguttara Nikaya, Uposatha Sutta. Thus have I heard. At one time the Blessed One was residing in Jetavana, the monastery of Anatha Pindika, near Savatthi. At that time the Blessed One, having called all the bhikkhus together, addressed them thus, "Bhikkhus." The bhikkhus answered in assent, "Lord." The bhikkhus then prepared themselves for the following teaching. The Blessed One then gave them the following teaching on Uposatha. Bhikkhus, Uposatha observance is comprised of 8 factors, which the Aryan, the noble disciples, observes and which brings glorious and radiant fruit and benefit. Bhikkhus, what is Uposatha, which, observed by the Aryan disciples, the noble disciples, brings glorious and radiant fruit and benefit? 1. Bhikkhus, the noble disciples in this Dhamma reflect thus. All Arahants, as long as the life lasts, have given up the intentional taking of life. The club, stick and sword have been laid down. They have shame and fear of wrongdoing, of doing evil. and are compassionate and kind toward all beings. All of you who have given up the intentional taking of life, have put down all weapons, are possessed of shame and fear of wrongdoing, and are compassionate toward all living beings. For all this day and night, in this manner, we will be known as having followed the Arahants, and the Uposatha observance will have been observed by you. This is the first factor of the Uposatha observance, not to kill. 2. Bhikkhus, noble disciples in this religion, reflect thus. All Arahants, for as long as this life lasts, have given up taking what is not given. They only take what is given. I intend on taking only what is given. They are not thieves. Their behavior is spotless. All of you also here have given up the taking of what is not given, and are ones who do not take what is not given, and you are one who are intent on taking only what is given, and you are not thieves. Your behavior is spotless. For all of this day and night, in this manner, you will be known as having followed the Arahants, and the Uposatha observance will have been observed by you. This is the second factor of Uposatha, not to steal. Bhikkhus, disciples in this religion, reflects us. All Arahants, for as long as life lasts, have given up what is an obstacle to the noble life. They have given up all sexual activity. They do not mate with others, nor do they masturbate. Their practice is like that of Brahma. They are far from sexual intercourse, which is the practice of lay people. All of you have given up that which is an obstacle for the Brahma following, and behave like a Brahma. Your behavior is far from sexual intercourse. For this day and night, in this manner, you will be known as having followed the Arahants, and the Uposatha observance will have been observed by you. And this is the third factor of the observance, Uposatha Day, not to have sex, neither with others nor with oneself. 4. Bhikkhus, noble disciples in this religion, reflect thus. All Arahants, for as long as life lasts, and giving up the telling of lies, they utter only truth. They are intent only on the truth. Their speech is firm and is composed of well reason. The speech does not waver from what is the mainstay for the world. All of you have also given up the telling of lies. You speak only the truth, and are intent only of what is true. Your speech is firm with reason. Your speech does not waver from what is the mainstay from the world. For all this day and night, in this manner, you will be known as having followed the Arahants, and the Uposatha will have been observed by you. This is the fourth factor of the Uposatha observance, to speak the truth and never to tell a lie. 5. Bhikkhus, Arahant disciples in this religion, reflects us. All Arahants, for as long as this life lasts, have given up taking liquors or intoxicants, have given up any intoxication that causes carelessness. They are far from any intoxication. All of you have also given up liquors, spirits, alcohol, and intoxicants. You abstain from drink which causes carelessness. For all this day and night, and in this manner, you will be known as having followed the Arahants, and the Uposatha will have been served by you. This is the fifth factor of the Uposatha, not to intoxicate, not to use anything that causes carelessness, neglect, and self-destruction. 6. Bhikkhus, Arahant disciples in this religion, reflect thus. All Arahants, for as long as this life lasts, eat at one time only,
and do not partake of fruit in the evening. They abstain from eating food at the wrong time, that is, after 12 o'clock noon. All of you also here eat only at one time and do not partake of food in the evening. You abstain from food at the wrong time. For all this day and night in this manner, you will be known as having followed the Arahants, and the Uposatha observance have been observed by you. This is the sixth factor of the Uposatha observance. 7. Bhikkhus, noble disciples, in this Dhamma and discipline reflect thus. All Arahants, for as long as life lasts, have given up singing and dancing, the playing of musical instruments, and the watching of entertainments, which are stumbling blocks to that which is wholesome. Nor do they bedeck themselves with ornaments, jewelry, flowers, or perfume. All of you have also given up singing and dancing, playing musical instruments, and the watching of shows, entertainments, and so on, which are stumbling blocks to what is advantageous. You do not bedeck yourself with ornaments, flowers, jewelry, or perfume. For all of this day and night in this manner, you will be known as having followed the Arahants, and the Uposatha observance will have been observed by you. This is the seventh factor of the Uposatha observance. 8. Bhikkhus, noble disciples in this religion reflect thus. All Arahants, for as long as life lasts, has given up living on large or high beds. They are content with low beds or bedding made of grass. All of you have also given up lying on large or high beds. You are content with low beds or beds made of grass. For this day and night in this manner, you will be known as having followed the Arahants, and the Uposatha will have been observed by you. This is the eighth factor of the Uposatha. Bhikkhus, the Uposatha is comprised of these eight factors, which the Arahants, the noble disciples observe, and is of great and glorious fruit and benefit. Thus spoke the Blessed One, and the Uposatha observance, the Bhikkhus, were delighted and rejoiced in his words. And then comes the Mula Uposatha Sutta, the Roots Sutta, or speech on the Uposatha observance. I have heard that on one occasion the Blessed One was staying in Savatthi, at the Eastern Monastery, the place of Migara's mother. Now at that time, it being the Uposatha observance day, Visakha, Migara's mother, went to the Blessed One in the middle of the day, and on her arrival, having bowed down to him, sat on one side. As she was sitting there, the Blessed One said to her, "Well now, Visakha, why are you coming in the middle of the day?" "Today I am observing Uposatha, Lord." "Ah well, when Visakha, there are these three Uposathas." "Which three?" "The Uposatha of a cowherd, the Uposatha of a Jain, and the Uposatha of the noble ones." "And what is the Uposatha of a cowherd?" "Just as when a cowherd returns the cattle to the owners in the evening," he reflects, "today the cattle wandered to this spot and to that spot. They drank at this spot and that spot. Tomorrow they will wander to this spot and that spot. They will drink at this spot and that spot." In the same way, there is this case where a certain person, observing the Uposatha, reflects, "Today I ate this sort of non-stable food and that sort of stable food. Tomorrow I will eat this sort of non-stable food and that sort of stable food." He spends the day with an awareness imbued with that greed, with that desire of what to eat. Such is the Uposatha of a cowherd, Visakha. When this Uposatha of a cowherd is undertaken, it is not of great fruit or great benefit, not of great glory or great radiance. And what is the Uposatha of the Jains, the contemplatives called the Digantas? They get the disciple to undertake the following practice. Here, they say, my good man, lay down the rod with regard to beings who live more than 100 leagues to the east, more than 100 leagues to the west, more than 100 leagues to the north, more than 100 leagues to the south. They thus get the disciple to undertake kindness and sympathy to some beings, but not to others. On the Uposatha day, they get their disciple to undertake the following practice. Here, my good man, having stripped off all your clothes, say this. I am nothing by anything or of anything. There is nothing by anything or of anything that is mine. Yet in spite of that, his parents know him. Ah, this is our child. And he knows of them. Ah, these are my parents. His wives and children know of him. Ah, this is our husband and father. And he knows of them that they are my wives and children. His workers and slaves know him of that. Ah, this is our boss, this is our master. And he knows of them that these are our workers and slaves. Thus, at the time when he should be persuaded to undertake truthfulness, he is persuaded to undertake falsehood. At the end of the night, he resumes the consumption of his belongings, even though they aren't given back to him. This counts as stealings, I tell you. Such is the Uposatha of the Jains, Visakha. When this Uposatha of the Jains is undertaken, it is not of great fruit, of great benefit, nor of great glory, or great radiance. And what is the Uposatha of the Noble Ones? It is the cleaning of the defiled mind with the proper technique. And how is the defiled mind purified? With the proper technique. There is a case where the disciple of the Noble Ones reflects on the Tathagata thus. Indeed, the Blessed One is worthy and rightly self-awakened, consummate in knowledge and behavior, well gone, an expert with regard to the world, unexcelled as the trainer of those people to be fit to be tamed, the teacher of the divine beings and the human beings, awakened and blessed. As he is recollecting the thus gone, the thus come one, his mind is calmed and joy arises. The defilement of his mind are abandoned, just as when the head is cleansed with the proper soap. This is how the head is cleaned through the proper technique, using the proper shampoo. In the same way, the defiled mind is purified through the proper technique. And how is the defiled mind purified through the proper technique? There is a case where the disciple of the Noble Ones reflects on the Tathagata thus. As he is recollecting the Buddha, his mind is cleansed and joy arises. The defilements of his mind are left. He is thus called a disciple of the Noble Ones, undertaking the Brahma Uposatha. He lives with the Brahma. It is owing to the Brahma that his mind is calmed, that joy arises, and whatever defilements are in his mind, they are abandoned. This is how the defiled mind is cleaned through the proper technique. Again, how is it that through observance the mind is purified through the proper technique? There is a case where the disciple of the Noble Ones recollects his own virtues thus. Ah, this is my morality, this is my sila, this is my ethical conduct, is untorn, unbroken, unspotted, unsplattered, liberating, praised by the wise, untarnished, conducive to concentration. As he is recollecting his virtue thus, his mind is calm and joy arises. The defilement of his mind are abandoned, just as when a mirror is cleaned through the proper technique of using oil and ashes and the proper human effort. This is how a mirror is cleaned through the proper technique. In the same way, the defiled mind is cleaned through the proper technique. So, is the remembrance, the recollection of the noble disciple of his own purity, his own virtues. As he is recollecting his own purity, his own innocence, then joy arises. And with this joy, the defilements of his mind are abandoned. He is thus called a disciple of the Noble Ones, undertaking the Observance Day. He lives with this moral purity, this virtue, this ethical rightness. It is owing to this virtue that his mind is calmed, and that joy arises, and that whatever defilement there are in his mind, they are abandoned. This is how the defiled mind is cleaned through the proper technique. Again, the observance of the Noble Ones on the Uposatha Day is cleaning the defiled mind through the proper technique. How? Yes, there is a case where the disciple of the Noble Ones recollects the devasas. They are the devas of the four great kings. They are the devas of the 33, the yama devas, the contented devas, the devas who delight in creation, the devas who have power over others' creations, and the devas of the brahmas who are retinue, and the devas beyond even them. Whatever condition they were endowed with when falling away from this life, they re-arose there. This is the very same sort of conviction and faith and confidence in the Dhamma is present in me also. Whatever virtue they were endowed with when falling away from their life, making them re-arise there as deva, the very same sort or kind of moral purity, of virtue, of ethics, is also present in me. Whatever learning they were endowed with when they fall away from life, thereby making them re-arouse there as a deva, the same sort of learning is present in me as well. Whatever generosity they were endowed with when falling away from this life, making them re-arise there as a deva, the very same sort of generosity is present in me as well. Whatever discrimination, understanding, comprehension they had when falling away from their life, making them re-arise there as a deva, that comprehension, that understanding, that discernment is present in me as well. As is recollecting the divine devas, his mind is calmed and joy arises. The defilement of his mind are abandoned, just as when gold is cleansed through the proper technique. And how is gold cleaned through the proper technique? Through the use of a furnace, salt, earth, red chalk and a blowpipe, tongs and the appropriate human effort. The gold is then heated up and the dirt is filtered off. Heated up again, the dirt is filtered off. Heated up again, the dirt is filtered off. This is how gold is cleaned through the proper technique. In the same way, the defiled mind is cleaned through the proper technique. And how is a defiled mind cleaned through the proper technique? There is a case where the disciple of the Noble Ones recollect the devas. As he is recollecting the divine devas, his mind is purified, and joy arises. The defilements of his mind are abandoned. He is thus called a disciple of the Noble Ones, undertaking the Divine Observance Day. He lives with the divine devas. It is owing to the devas that his mind is calmed, that joy arises, and whatever defilement there are in his mind, by that are abandoned. This is how the defiled mind is cleaned through the proper technique. Furthermore, the disciple of the Noble Ones reflect thus. As long as they live, the Arahants, abandoning the taking of life, abstain from the taking of life, avoid all killing. They dwell with the rod and stick laid down, their knife left unscrupulous, merciful, and compassionate for the welfare of all beings. Today I too, for this day and night, abandoning the taking of life, abstaining from the taking of life, I dwell with the stick laid down, the knife left down, scrupulous, merciful, compassionate for the welfare of all beings. By the means of this factor, I emulate the Arahants, and my Uposatha Observance Day will be rightly observed. As long as they live, the Arahants, avoiding stealing, abstaining from taking what is not given. They take only what is offered, what is given. They live not by stealing or fraud, and by means of that self they become pure. Today I too, for this day and night, abandoning the taking of what is not giving, and I void from taking what is not given. I take only and accept only what is given. I live not by stealing, nor by means of other fraudulent methods of livelihood. By this means of this factor I emulate the Arahants, and my Uposatha observance will be observed. As long as they live, the Arahants, abandoning uncelibacy, live a celibate life, aloof, refraining from the sexual act that is the villager's way. Today I too, from this day and night, abandoning uncelibacy, live the celibate life, avoiding all sexual activity, copulation as well as masturbation, aloof, refraining from the sexual act that is the villager's way. I thereby emulate the Arahants, and my Uposatha day will be fully observed. As long as they live, the Arahants, avoiding all false speech, abstaining from all lies, they speak the truth, hold on to the truth. They are firm, reliable, no deceivers of the world. Today I too, for this day and night, abandoning all false speech, abstaining from all lying, pretending, I speak the truth, stick to the truth, are firm, reliable, no deceiver of the world. By means of this factor, I emulate the Arahants, and my Uposatha day will be fully observed. As long as I live, the Arahants live on only one meal a day, abstaining from food at night. They avoid taking food at the wrong time of the day, that is, afternoon. Today I too, for this day and night, live on one meal only, abstaining from food at night, refraining from food at the wrong time. By means of this factor, I emulate the Arahants, and my Uposatha observance will be complete. As long as I live, the Arahants abstain from dancing, singing, music, watching shows, wearing garlands, beautifying themselves with perfumes and cosmetics. Today I too, for this day and night, abstain from dancing, singing, music, watching shows, wearing garlands, beautifying myself with perfumes and cosmetics. By this factor, I emulate the Arahants, and my Uposatha day, my observance, will be observed. As long as they live, the Arahants, abandoning high and imposing seats and beds, abstain from high and imposing seats and beds. They make low beds, a pallet, or a spread of straw. Today I too, for this day and night, abandoning high and imposing seats and beds, I make a low bed on a pallet or a spread of straw. By means of this factor, I emulate the Arahants, and my Uposatha day will be observed. Such is the Uposatha of the Noble Ones, Visakha. When this Uposatha of the Noble Ones is undertaken, it is of great fruit and great benefit, of great glory and great radiance. And how is it of great fruit and great glory and great radiance? Suppose that one was to exercise kingship, rule, and sovereignty over the 16 great lands in India, replete with the seven Cheshires, that is, over the Angas, Magadhans, Kasis, Kosalans, Vayans, Malans, Sitis, Vansans, Kurus, Panchalas, Machas, Surasenas, Asakas, Avantis, Gandharans, and Kambuyans. It would not be worth 1/16 of this Uposatha endowed with the eight factors. Why is that so? Kingship over human beings is a meager thing, a lean thing, a low thing, when compared with heavenly bliss. 50 years are equal to one day and night, among the devas of the four great kings. 30 such days and nights makes a month, and 12 such months make a year. 500 such heavenly years constitute the lifespans of the devas of the four great kings. Now, it is possible that a certain man or woman, from having observed the Uposatha endowed with these eight factors, on the breakup of the body, right after death, might be reborn among the devas of the four great kings. It was in reference to this it was said, kingship over human beings are a meager, lean thing when compared to heavenly bliss. A human century is equal to one day and night among the devas of the 33. 30 such day and nights make a month. 1,000 of such heavenly years constitute the lifespans among the devas of the 33. Now it's possible that a man or a woman, from having observed this Uposatha endowed with these eight factors, on the breakup of the body, after death, might be reborn among the devas of the 33. It was in reference to this fact that it was said, kingship over human beings is a meager, lean thing when compared to heavenly bliss. Two human centuries are equal to one day and night among the Jama devas. 2,000 such heavenly years constitute the lifespan among the Yama devas. 4 centuries are equal to one day and night among the contented Tusita devas. 4,000 such heavenly years constitute the lifespan among the contented devas. 8 human centuries are equal to one day and night among the devas who delight in creation. 8,000 such heavenly years constitute the lifespan among the devas who delight in creation. 16 human centuries, 1,600 years, equals one day and night among the devas who have power over others, creations. 30 such days and nights makes a month. 12 such months makes a year. 16,000 such divine years constitute the lifespan among the devas who have the power over the creations of others. Now it is possible that a certain man or a certain woman, from having observed this Uposatha observance endowed with eight factors, at death and the breakup of the body, might be reborn among the devas who have power over the creations of others. It was in reference to this fact that it was said, kingship over human beings is a meager thing when compared with heavenly bliss. One should not kill a being or take what is not given. One should not tell a lie or be a drinker of strong drink or use intoxicants. One should abstain from uncelibacy, the sexual act. One should not eat at night, the wrong time of the day. One should not wear nice clothes or use perfumes. One should sleep on the mat on a ground spread out. For this eight-factored Uposatha have been proclaimed by the Awakened One to lead to the end of suffering and stress. The moon and the sun both fare to sea, shedding radiance wherever they go, scattering darkness all over, brighten the sky, illuminating all the quarters. Under their light is found great wealth, pearl, crystal, all kinds of gems, platinum, gold, and the refined gold called hataka. Yet all this gold, all these diamonds, all this platinum, are not worth 1/16 of the eight-factored Uposatha.
Hey. So I just want to share to you with you what I'm doing here, 5 o'clock in the morning, at poor days, having been up all night long. Then, instead of sitting meditation, when you become fatigued, then it's good to do walking meditation. Like we'll now do here, out in the outside here. And then, because it's cool in the tropical night, then one can just walk and walk and walk while reflecting on impermanence and reflecting on suffering and reflecting on no self. That's very good in the tropical night, because then you get refreshed. You're still training, you're still doing reflection. You're still making progress towards Nirvana. So this is the fact that one cannot sit all night long and do sitting meditation because one falls asleep. This doesn't mean that one cannot train. One can still train at night, turning on the inner light, reflecting on the four satipatthanas, the four foundations of awareness, seeing the body only as an empty frame, seeing the feelings only as passing bubbles of emotional reactions, seeing the mind just as a conditioned, ever-changing set of moods, and seeing all phenomena as mental states, neither as me, nor mine, nor what I am, nor as lasting, nor as stable, nor as self, nor as happiness, nor as safety, nor as something to be clung to, nor as something safe, but just as it really is, this passing appearance of various mental states, skillful or unskillful. And the night is beautiful. It's all silent. And the moon has gone down. So much for today. Observance Day. Observance Night. 1st January 2018. So, I can share you with you, it's very good practice. Every new moon and every full moon day, no sleep, no eating, only training. Then you make progress. Thank you. Now, Tasso, Bhagavanta, Arahanto, Samma Sambuddhassa, worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the best Buddha in the world. And we just keep walking. Just keep walking. Not giving up. Not putting down the burden. Lasting.